Welcome to this evening's media discussion on journalism education and journalism itself in Slovakia. My name is Tom Nicholson. I work with a Trend Business Weekly. I've been a journalist in Slovakia for 15 years, and this discussion will be in both English and Slovak, depending on the feelings of the people speaking. So I was asked to lead off in English, but we can switch to Slovak at any time. I'd like to briefly introduce the people who will be forming our panel tonight. On my right, my far right, is Mr. Lukáš Díko, who is the editor-in-chief of TV Markíza, which is the most watched television in Slovakia, which makes him the boss of the most influential news department in the country. He's worked in the past for TA3, the BBC World Service, SME, and Radio Twist, so he's got a broad range of media experience in Slovakia. Next to him is Mr. Branislav Ondrašík, with whom I teach at the Pan-European University. His name changes every year, so I hesitate. It's one of the largest private universities in Slovakia, and he is an assistant professor there and deputy director of the Mass Media Institute. I know it's not the exact name, but it's like that. He was also Fulbright Scholar at Michigan State University and Chevening Scholar at the University of Leeds. And he has also worked as a journalist in the past for SME and Hospodárske noviny. So he combines both academic experience of Slovakia and the West, as well as on-the-job journalism experience. To my left is Dr. Svetlana Hlavčáková, who is associate professor and head of the journalism department at Comenius University, which I'm sure you all know is the largest and most prestigious university in the country. And she has also held academic positions in Sweden and the Czech Republic, and she specializes in news agency journalism, if I'm not wrong.
You are right.
I'm right. Wonderful. And finally, on my far left is Michael Jordan, who is an American foreign correspondent who is currently based in Bratislava. But during his career, he's reported from 25 different countries, and his work has appeared in, I think, the Christian Science Monitor, Foreign Affairs, and a variety of publications. And he also combines that useful on-the-job as well as teaching experience. He's taught at a number of universities around the world, including the University of Saints Cyril and Methodius in Trnava. So we have a very good panel of people with us tonight, and I'm looking forward to their contributions on the topic of media. I'd just like to begin. We're going to be talking, and then we'll be taking questions or comments from the audience, and I'd like to call on everybody to be as brief as they possibly can, including you, but particularly me, I guess, and colleagues, because there's a lot of topics to cover, and I'm sure everybody has a lot of opinions they want to get out there. So just by way of introduction, I wanted to recall a court trial I was at recently, and the man in the dock, the man who was charged with fraud, sorry, not fraud, it was assault in an organized gang. His name is Michal Hrbáček, and some of you may remember him from the kidnapping of Kovács Jr. in 1995. Former Secret Service officer, spent three tours in pretrial custody, and in 2006 he was accused of using some ex and serving policemen in black masks to beat up a lawyer in Bratislava who was apparently holding up things in the Veritel debt agency. Whatever the origins of it, Mr. Hrbáček was in court on the decisive day. The prosecution had a state witness who was a policeman who had taken part in the assault and who had nothing to gain by fingering Mr. Hrbáček, because until he started talking, no one knew that he was involved in this assault. His testimony, I think, most people found credible. There were two small discrepancies in his testimony, which the judge used to dismiss it entirely, saying that, well, if a witness lies once for me, he is always a liar. Mr. Hrbáček, on the other hand, had four witnesses giving him an alibi, and these witnesses were able to remember exactly what he had been drinking and wearing 5 years ago on a particular day. And, of course, the judge found Mr. Hrbáček innocent, and after the trial, I went to the lead prosecutor on the case, whose name is Petr Šufliarski, and he's one of the top stars of the Slovak prosecution. And I said, Petr, what was that? And he said, I don't know. He had some witnesses, and I asked, well, who were they? And he didn't know. Now, I mean, I'd find out through very brief work on the Business Register and on Google that one was Josef Didi, who was Mr. Hrbacek's personal bodyguard. The other was his common-law wife. The third was a man, Milan Maniak, with whom he owns brothels in Slovakia and the Czech Republic. And the last one was Svetopluk Ratuski, who was his boss at the Secret Service at the time of the Kovac kidnapping. And it just kind of, it hit me. The state does not have what it takes to put high-level criminals in jail. It just doesn't. Not only is the prosecution not interested in pushing ahead high-level cases like Mr. Fico's voice on the tape or SDKU funding, but even in a case like this, the prosecution is simply unaware of who they are up against and unwilling to put in the time to put these people behind bars. So it struck me that in a country like Slovakia, in addition to its normal important functions in democracy, the media has another important function, and that is to make up for a broken justice system. Not only do we have the task of putting information in the hands of people who need it to make decisions in a democracy, but we and our work are sometimes the only satisfaction people will get. Because the courts aren't going to put them in jail, the prosecution isn't going to bring the case, and the police aren't going to investigate reliably. So it seems to me that in this country, such a young country with such a young media, the media, on the other hand, has a huge role, and one of the things we're here to find out tonight is how well they're doing at that job. So perhaps, Mr. Diko, we could lead off with you. Do you agree that the media has a particularly large role, and how do you think they're doing?
Takže ja prepnem do slovenčiny.
Môžem úplne kľudne po slovensky, jasne.
A neviem, či to bude odo mňa objektívne, ako náhľad na slovenské médiá. Ale myslím si, že tá situácia 22 rokov po Nežnej revolúcii sa mení a posúva sa dopredu. A myslím si, že médiá sa stále učia a v istom spôsobe aj zlepšujú. Na začiatku, keď sme tu stáli, sme sa rozprávali o tom, my sme obidva absolventi Univerzity Komenského, o tom, akú som ja mal diplomovú prácu a bolo to kríze slovenskej žurnalistiky z pohľadu novinárskej etiky pred 8 rokmi. A ja som si teraz nedávno opäť prečítal tú prácu a zistil som, že v tomto ohľade sa napríklad médiá zlepšili a v mnohých veciach už konajú eticky a istým spôsobom aj nový etický kódex syndikátu, teda etický kódex slovenského novinára je veľkým prínosom k tomu, aby médiá sa čo najlepšie vyrovnávali s tými výzvami, ktoré pred nimi stoja. Aj s takými, ako si ty spomínala, s tým, aby sa snažili divákom, čitateľom, poslucháčom povedať, čo sa v tejto krajine naozaj deje. Možno kto je dobrý a kto zlý. A aj to, prečo v istých momentoch zistíme, že jediným spôsobom, ako Tom povedal, ako dať spravodlivosti zadosť, je povedať ľuďom, že tento človek niekoho zbil, niekoho vydieral, niekoho okradol, ale súdy ho neodsúdili. Čiže myslím si, že tá situácia je špecifická práve tým prechodným obdobím, práve tým, že v slovenských médiách pôsobí veľmi veľa mladých ľudí. Myslím si, že asi v málo krajinách na svete by som ja v mojom veku mohol byť šéf-redaktorom spravodajstva najsledovanejšej televízie. Je to obrovská zodpovednosť a človek sa učí každý deň, aby dokázal svojim redaktorom poradiť alebo rozhodnúť v otázkach, keď si nevedia poradiť. A jednoducho tá situácia je komplikovaná, je vo vývoji, ale myslím si, že médiá sa zlepšujú, aj keď najmä v poslednom čase je vidieť, že mladí ľudia sa už inak stavajú k tej práci a že je to špecifikum. Moja skúsenosť je z televíznej žurnalistiky, že mnohí si myslia, že robiť reportéra v televízii je len byť na obrazovke a nie je za tým žiadna práca, žiaden výskum, žiadne pátranie, žiadne stretnutia, žiadne rozhovory.
Pani Hlavčáková, pani doktorka. Lukáš je váš bývalý študent? Hej, tak čo si myslíte, akože médiá robí svoju prácu dobre, alebo či ešte tam sú veľké lapsusy?
No ja myslím, že Lukáš to v celku vystižne zhodnotil, že tá situácia napreduje, že tá situácia sa zlepšuje. Samozrejme, stále nemôžeme s tým byť spokojní, ako mediálna scéna na Slovensku pôsobí a ako vyzerá, pretože to povedomie etických zásad a zodpovednosti za to, čo novinár konkrétne urobí, ako rozhodne o osudoch ľudí, je veľmi dôležité. Tu nejde len o tú investigatívu, ale celkovo o to, že tie médiá naozaj zasahujú do životov ľudí. Takže v tomto zmysle tá žurnalistika pokračuje. Naučili sme sa vnímať médiá ako slobodné, alebo aspoň teda ten duálny systém to umožnil, že dnes sa môžeme dozvedieť teda z viacerých, zo širokospektrálnych zdrojov informácie. Na druhej strane tá mladosť je možno aj do istej miery na prekážku, pretože celá ako keby jedna generácia novinárov vypadla, ktorá mohla a mala odovzdávať skúsenosti. Ono, mať skúsenosti nie je zásluha, ale výsada. A v tom je taká spravodlivosť na svete, že tie skúsenosti jednoducho človek musí získať vekom a praxou.
Ale zdá sa mi, že verejnosť vníma médiá skôr tak najlepšie neutrálne a skôr negatívne. A možno pod vplyv politikov, ktorí veľakrát majú kritiku voči médií. Ale možno Braňo, vedel by ti si povedať, že či skôr publikum má pravdu, že médiá nerobia svoju prácu a nemáme ich dôverovať? Alebo...
Či si médiá teda naplňajú svoju úlohu, ktorú by mali v slovenskej spoločnosti, alebo nenaplňajú, je jedna otázka. A faktom však zostáva to, že akýkoľvek médiá, hoci aj horšie, ale médiá, ktoré sú slobodné, vykonávajú aspoň určitú kontrolnú funkciu. Čiže keby publikum by malo chápať, teda aj ľudia by mali chápať, že keď počúvajú Roberta Fica, alebo aj súčasnú premiérku, alebo proste hoci koho z politiky, keď zaútočí na médiá, mali by myslieť na to, že je to vlastne útok. Keď tie médiá nebudú, ktoré sú aspoň nejakou poslednou kontrolou, tak už to bude naozaj, opäť sa vrátime k moci nejakej jednej ideológie strany a proste zanikne nejaká demokracia alebo skutočná sloboda. Mne sa páčila táto debata, ako si ju začal s tou správou, ktorá pre niekoho mohla vyzerať šokujúca, ale na Slovensku to už nie je ani tak veľmi šokujúce, ako je to skôr nejaký pattern, že sa to deje. A Lukáš bol vcelku opatrný v tom, čo hovoril, čo chápem. Samozrejme, je tu v ťažkej pozícii v tejto debate. A ja môžem povedať niektoré veci nahlas, keďže momentálne sa nezodpovedám žiadnemu médiu, ani nebudem čeliť žiadnym žalobám, pravdepodobne. Čo ja vidím ako najväčší problém, niekoľkých líniách najväčší problém žurnalistiky na Slovensku, a tento problém súvisí práve s politikou a s tou kultúrou korupcie a ako to funguje. Ako môžeme očakávať, aby povedzme televízia Markíza si udržala svoju investigatívnu unit, keď čelí každou druhou reportážou potenciálnemu súdnemu procesu, pri ktorom prehrá 1 000 000 eur, povedzme. Ako môžeme očakávať, že denník SME bude naozaj tak veľmi podporovať každú kauzu, do ktorej by sa mohol pustiť, keď potenciálne čelí ďalšie žalobe. Ako si ty povedal presne, súd má takmer 100% pravdepodobnosť, že súd rozhodne voči ním. A ešte k tomu publikum sa možno pridá aj na stranu tých sudcov alebo tých politikov, pretože nechápe túto dôležitú kontrolnú rolu médií. Ale není teda vina iba na súdoch a na politikoch a na politike. Problém je aj v médiách samotných, v manažmente médií, skôr na tej úrovni mediálnych vlastníkov, ktorí vlastne sme mali pred chvíľou s kolegom tú debatu o tom, prečo ľudia odchádzajú z médií. Ja som robil v médiách 12 rokov. A po tých troch som odišiel z médií. Naozaj novinári pociťujú istú formu frustrácie, že sa nemôžu naplno realizovať. Ideály, s ktorými tam prišli, sa nenapĺňajú. A vo väčšine slovenských médií tieto médiá ani nemajú nejakú vôľu investovať do tejto ľudskej sily. Vychovajú si dobrého novinára a keď vám proste potom povie, že odíde, lebo sa mu nepáči, akým spôsobom tam sa to vyvíja, tak mu riaditeľ vydavateľstva alebo možno aj šéfredaktor povie, že OK, tak choď, nájdeme si troch študentov namiesto teba. A nevždy, nevravím, že to je vždy, negeneralizujem, ale často to tak funguje v slovenských médiách, že toho novinára naozaj vyždímajú ako pomaranč. A samozrejme, o tom sa asi budeme baviť, takže ja rád proste poviem veci takto otvorene.
And to maybe to your list, I would add one thing, that with this, the general departure of older journalists, there is a lack of maturity, I think, in many news departments. And that is reflected in one particular way. It's enough for a sign of corruption to come up, or some kind of indication, and the media tends to attack it without giving its readers any context. Where does this incidence of corruption sit in contrast to this one? Are the Hayakovtsi really on the same level as Nastankovi Tender? And there's nothing wrong with going after the Hayakovtsi, but again, to have a strong personality in the midst, leading a news department who is able to say, look, all right, 2 days, 3 days, fine. 14 days, it's ridiculous. And I think, I don't know what Lukács' news department looks like, but in some that I've been a part of, the editor-in-chief, I think, is worried that his journalists will accuse him of being soft on these people, or, you know, somebody got to him, somebody's got influence over him. So it's almost like journalists attack both good and bad in this country without any kind of context and without any kind of sense of how the world really works. And I believe that's the fault of the fact that we have so few older and more mature journalists leading these news organizations. But what do you think?
Môžem povedať, že ja mám niečo cez 30 a ja sa už považujem za staršiu generáciu slovenských novinárov. Čo si myslím, že to hovorí samo za seba. Je to naozaj, je to bohužiaľ na Slovensku fakt a bol tu pred časom kongres Medzinárodného tlačového inštitútu v Bratislave a bol som ja pozvaný ako hosť na jednu už takú slávnostnú udalosť. A sedel som pri stole ja a so mnou reportéri z celého sveta, Jim Clancy, boli tam ľudia z inštitútu Pointer z Floridy a to boli už všetko páni v rokoch, 50-60 a presne toto bola tá naša debata. A ja som sa im snažil vysvetliť, že mnohí ľudia, ktorí na Slovensku pôsobia v médiách, vnímajú médiá ako prostriedok, nie ako cieľ. Že jednoducho je to pre nich nejaká prestupná stanica niekam, kdežto, budem hovoriť za seba, keď kým uživím svoju rodinu z toho, čo zarobím ako novinár, tak budem novinár, je istá skupina ľudí, ktorí sú novinári, pretože to považujú za správne a pretože to berú ako svoje poslanie, nie ako svoju prácu. A vlastne je ale druhá skupina ľudí, ktorí to naozaj berú ako prostriedok a odrazový mostík niekam inam. A myslím si, že tam je tiež časť toho problému, že ľudia prídu do médií, aby sa svojím spôsobom ukázali, aby sa dostali do nejakej spoločnosti. Nezaoberajú sa ani takto nejakou, keď to nazvem, technickou a každodennou drinou, ale skôr sa zaoberajú tým, ako sám seba čo najlepšie predať a po dvoch, troch rokoch odchádzajú niekam inám. A nemyslím si, že to platí na všetkých kolegov, ktorí od nás odišli po zmene vlády na hovorcovské posty, ale napríklad aj na hovorcovské posty.
It looks like an unwelcome or a very difficult mix. On the one hand, you've got a hugely important role, and on the other hand, a very young journalistic core, many of whom don't see journalism as an end in itself, but as a way to get where they're going. Obviously, in such a situation, it's crucial that we start out right, that we get young journalists properly prepared and ready to do good things in their craft. Mike, you've got experience of both the American and Slovak journalism education. What do you have to say on the matter?
Well, there's really so much to talk about, and I took notes, and I feel like I have a comment in response to everything that was said here. Just to say a couple words, because I'm a bit fearful of wading too deeply into Slovak journalism today, because I'm not an expert on Slovak journalism, so I don't want to just start talking about something I don't know so well. But I have lived and worked as a journalist here in Central Europe for 18 years now, just about 18 years. First in Budapest for 6 years, now in Slovakia for 5 years. I've taught journalism in Slovakia and in the Czech Republic, and now I'm also teaching Chinese journalists in Hong Kong. So what I want to try to do is explain a bit of a regional context that for those of you out there may think, the Slovak context, the Slovak situation is so dark, so bleak, okay? One thing I can explain at least is from what I see, it's a clear pattern, a clear trend across the region. It is part of the whole post-communist transition period. It's been 22 years and counting. It's still going on. It's not over. I was very happy to have an opportunity to teach journalism here for 2 years in Trnava at St. Cyril and Method. But I want to just address a couple points first. One thing that Tom started off when he's talking about the justice system, that now the media has this really crucial role because of the justice system. Well, I see it even deeper than that. It's really about the quality of democracy itself in Slovakia, in Central Europe. It's not unique again. I mean, the Hungarian media is dealing with the same thing. The Czech Republic, I mean, if you look at Hungary next door, not to talk too much about the Hungarians, I love them, but that's another topic, is what's happening there with Viktor Orban and the various steps he's taking against the Constitution. Well, critics, activists, civil society participants now feel the need to educate the Hungarian public about democracy, why this is important, why press freedom is important. I mean, obviously the public is preoccupied, their thoughts are dominated by their own economic situation, their own difficult lives, their own struggle to survive. And if you ask them, would you prefer to have better quality meat or free media, they may say, hey, better quality meat, a nice holiday, a nice car, a nice apartment, that's all I want out of life. And so I think there's some general context about people's motivations or the public lack of interest or apathy and the role the media plays in cementing the foundation of democracy itself. Okay, so I think it's even deeper than what you said. If I could make a couple more points, is that okay? A couple more counterpoints? Yes? Yeah, that's okay. You know, speaking of the young people, one thing that Svetlana mentioned about the young people, again, I was very fortunate to be able to teach in Trnava, to have a couple years teaching young Slovaks, and I can tell you a little bit about my experiences teaching these young people. On the one hand, youth is an issue for young journalists. Youth is an issue for young journalists everywhere in the world. Okay, when I was starting out, 21, 22, it's intimidating to ask tough questions, okay? On the one hand, to challenge people older than you, people like your parents, your grandparents, right? So young journalists are always going to make mistakes and be intimidated and easily pressured in that regard, okay? That's one thing. And that's another reason for why experience is so important, right? So you get to age 30, 40, that sort of, and you know how to handle these situations on the one hand. On the other hand, there are some specificities about the situation here in post-communist Eastern Europe. And the legacy of the past and being afraid to ask tough questions. Why? The most important question in all of journalism. Not just what the situation is. There is corruption in the criminal justice system, what have you. But why exactly the situation is the way it is. These are very difficult questions in my experience to teach young Slovaks, young Hungarians, young Czechs, because also the influence of their parents and their grandparents. Obviously, this is a major cultural shift we're talking about as well, right? Even, like I said, 22 years later, people still need to become encouraged, emboldened that, hey, we have a right to ask tough questions and to demand answers accountability, transparency from the elected and appointed officials. Okay, so I could tell you a couple of stories from Tornava, which I've written about. I wrote an article about it, but I don't want to dominate discussion too much. Can I cede the floor to another colleague right now?
Well, maybe I could pass it over to Pani Hlačáková. One of the things that I've noticed in teaching at Pan-European University is that I teach an investigative journalism course there for students who say they're going to be entering journalism. And two things. They don't know how to write. They don't know what a lead is. They don't know what a nut graph is. They don't know anything about the structure of a story. Not that their colleagues in the media are much better, but they have no idea, and no one has ever explained it to them or wanted anything from them out of it. Secondly, they are more interested in the names that I'm using than what I'm actually telling them. People like Horbacek or Ivan Leksa or Kovac Jr., I mean, these are just tabula rasa. These are young people in Slovakia intending to enter the media who have no idea who Ivan Leksa was and what he represented. So they are not being taught how to do their jobs in a very practical way, and they're not being taught about the environment in which they'll be doing their journalism. Now, that could be just a specific group of young people that I encountered, but it seems to me that the problem lies deeper with an over-formalized education system. I realize I'm really putting my hand into the hornet's nest here, but I just wanted to throw that out to Dr. Hlačáková. What do you think about that? Do you think that journalists coming out of Comenius have a strong enough grasp of the practical aspects of journalism?
No, ja musím povedať, že sú také dve tendencie na Slovensku vzdelávania. Jedna sa sústreďuje na to, aby na tom prvom stupni vzdelávania, bakalárskom stupni vzdelávania, sa študenti učili teoretické predmety a potom na magisterskom sa začali orientovať viac prakticky. A opačný trend, kde bakalársky stupeň vlastne by mal poskytnúť také základné vedomosti, znalosti z oblasti žurnalistiky, a ten magisterský, prípadne tretí stupeň, doktorandský, by mali byť už skôr zamerané výskumne alebo teoreticky s tým, že teda sa tam už vyučujú viac aplikované disciplíny na odbor žurnalistiky alebo mass-médií. Ja to vítam, túto pripomienku, pretože my to osie hniezdo pociťujeme takisto, ako ho pociťujú médiá v tom, že aj študenti, ktorí k nám prichádzajú, sú úplne inak pripravení, ako prichádzali, povedzme, pred 20 rokmi. Tento trend je jednoznačný a my sa koľkokrát pýtame, či my naozaj na univerzite máme suplovať stredné školy a, povedzme, učiť študentov základy gramatiky, pretože ich ju neovládajú. Takže toto sú problémy, ktoré sú komplexnejšie, ktoré nesúvisia len s žurnalistickou školou. Druhá otázka je, akým spôsobom teda sa orientovať v tom vzdelávaní. Myslím si, že máme na školách, dá sa povedať, akceptovateľné programy, učebné programy z Európou alebo so Spojenými štátmi, veď napokon po novembri 1989 nám chodili kolegovia zo Spojených štátov, z Rakúska, z Nemecka, z Británie pomáhať tieto osnovy nejakým spôsobom sformulovať. Ale ja vidím problém skôr v tej záplave novinárskych škôl a v tej záplave, ktorú produkujú, pretože mediálny trh na Slovensku je malý, nikdy nebude väčší. A ak jedna škola ročne produkuje 300 absolventov a je to jedna zo 7 alebo z 8, tak potom kde hľadať tú kvalitu, ako vyberať tú kvalitu a akým spôsobom tie médiá vôbec sú schopné pojať tú kvalitu. K tej otázke, ako pripravujeme, no snažíme sa tie základy, my na Univerzite Komenského sa snažíme teda tie základy do tých prvých rokov tesnať. Obrátená pyramída, žánre, slovenský jazyk, štylistika a všetky tieto základné potrebné kurzy, ktoré novinár potrebuje. V čom máme problém? To sú veci, do ktorých nás tlačí ministerstvo školstva. Vlastne výkon učiteľa sa dnes nehodnotí podľa kvality absolventov. My máme kvalitných absolventov, ako ste na úvod spomenuli, ale výkon učiteľa sa hodnotí podľa nejakých kvantitatívnych ukazateľov. Všetko sa zratúva. Koľko publikujete, kde publikujete, za to dostanete body, koľko máte študentov, za to dostanete, či publikujete v zahraničí alebo doma. Spoločenské a humanitné vedy predsa sa nemôžu porovnávať s prírodnými alebo technickými disciplínami a to, že učiteľ publikuje v zahraničí, vlastne možno vnímať aj tak, že ochudobňuje slovenskú kultúru. Pretože ak budeme mať dvojnásobný počet za štúdie uverejňované v zahraničí, kto bude písať do slovenských odborných časopisov. Táto kvantifikácia a tlačenie sústavne škôl do toho, aby prijímali čoraz vyšší a vyšší počet študentov, je veľmi negatívna, pretože ako sa dá pracovať individuálne s 300 študentmi v ročníku? Filozofická fakulta Univerzity Komenského prijala rozhodnutie, že obmedzí počet na maximum 50 a viac študentov jednoducho nebudeme môcť prijímať do ročníka, pretože by to ohrozilo kvalitu vzdelávania. Už s 50 študentmi sa veľmi ťažko pravidelne, kontinuálne, individuálne pracuje. Ja si pamätám, ešte keď študenti, títo naši absolventi študovali, boli žurnalistiky hodnotené ako kategória škôl s umeleckým zameraním, kde je naozaj dôraz kladený na to, aby sme pracovali individuálne. Tretí problém, ktorý je vo financiách. Rektor univerzity v poslednom rozhovore, ktorý som s ním čítala, uviedol, že má problém na prevádzku niektorých fakult. Nie to na výučbu. Má problém vyfinancovať prevádzku fakult. Tie finančné prostriedky sa z roka na rok znižujú. Vybavenosť katedier, keby nám nepomáhali mediálni partneri, tak máme naozaj problém s tým a nevidíme z toho tunela nejakú cestu von. Takže aj keby sme chceli...
Takže skôr inštitucionálne problémy nám viazne roky, vám viazne roky doteraz aspoň.
Jednu takú malú poznámku. Keď sa tu bavíme teda o... Ja som z konkurenčnej, kvázi konkurenčnej, my sme formálne konkurencia, ale samozrejme...
My sme spriateľená konkurencia.
My sme spriateľená konkurencia. Pani docentka bola naša profesorka na učiteľka na vysokej škole, takže my sme dvaja spolužiaci študenti a ona bola naša docentka, profesorka. Ale tam by som rozlišoval jednu vec. Tie mediálne školy, mediálne školstvo na Slovensku, stále aj Tom to tak povedal, že to sú novinári. Absolventi napríklad našej fakulty nie sú novinári. Nie sú iba novinári a ani náš profil nášho absolventa o tom ani nehovorí, že títo ľudia musí byť ako novinári a náš odbor sa ani nevolá žurnalistika. Takže pani docentka hovorí o žurnalistike, pretože to sú akože hardcore novinári. Takže aj ich profil, ich študenta sa trochu líši od profilu nášho študenta. Mediálna branža, telekomunikácie, multimédia, celý tento biznis, naozaj komunikácia narastlo do takých rozmerov, že patrí medzi najväčšie odvetvia služieb a biznisu, takže myslím si, že mediálne, respektíve ešte viac komunikačné školy sa uživia aj v takom množstve na Slovensku, v akom sú. Otázne však je, že či tých 300 absolventov, ktoré niektoré vysoké školy na Slovensku vyprodukujú, či naozaj budú mať to vzdelanie a naučia sa tých praktickým zručnostiam na tých rôznych predmetoch na tých školách. Takže To je úplne iná otázka. Ja tu nechcem robiť teda promo našej škole, čím som ho už vlastne urobil trochu. Lukáš to zvráti, on to videl naživo, ale nie. Samozrejme, každá škola má svoje problémy. veľa závisí aj od študentov. Myslím, že to bola správna poznámka, akí študenti prichádzajú na vysoké školy v súčasnej dobe. Nemyslím si, že to je iba slovenský problém. Myslím si, že to je problém celej západnej spoločnosti, ktorého následky uvidíme o 20 rokov, keď títo ľudia sa začnú dostávať, keď oni budú tá generácia, ktorá bude lídovať, tá stredná generácia. Takže naozaj si myslím, že to, čo teraz robí stredné a základné školstvo, to podhubie môže mať naozaj veľmi dramatické následky aj na stav občianskej spoločnosti.
Lukáš, z druhej strany rieke. Ako by ste hodnotili absolventov slovenských žurnalistických škôl?
Ja som mal takú otázku, taká otázka mi napadla pri tejto debate o školách a podmienkach, že keď je tu 7 komunikačných mediálnych škôl, ktoré produkujú každý rok stovky absolventov, prečo potom ja ako šéf-redaktor najsledovanejšieho spravodajstva mám problém nájsť redaktorov na niektoré svoje miesta? Na Banskej Bystrici sme hľadali pol roka redaktora a nakoniec to nebol ani absolvent, ani jednoducho potom už siahame do konkurencie a nie medzi absolventov.
A čo mi je problém?
Ja som na vlastnej koži zažil, povedal som, že ja Braňovi to promo trochu pokazím. Skupinu absolventov máme takú nepísanú dohodu s Paneurópskou univerzitou, že do našej redakcie pár študentov každý semester berieme na stáž a mali sme skupinu 5 dievčat, to je ináč dosť zaujímavé, že žurnalistika sa na Slovensku dosť feminizuje. A mali sme teda túto skupinu 5 študentiek, neviem, či to bol druhý alebo tretí ročník, kde už my, keď sme študovali, sme mali, bol to druhý ročník, teda Braňo hovorí, kde už my sme mali podľa mňa celkom jasno, keď sme študovali, čo chceme, prečo to robíme, mnohí z nás už pracovali v médiách. A ja som sa ich opýtal, že prečo teda chceli stáž v Markíze. Oni mi povedali, že lebo ich zaujíma televízia a tak ďalej. Potom som sa opýtal, že kto z nich chce byť novinár. A ani jedna z nich nechcela byť novinárom. A sedela a pritom bola na stáži, ktorá drvivá väčšina z tej stáže bola o práci redaktora spravodajstva v televízii. Čiže potom sme riešili rôzne veci, ako ich poslať aj na sa pozrieť do zábavy a na výrobu našich zábavných relácií a tak ďalej. Čiže ten problém je podľa mňa aj v školách, aj v ľuďoch, pretože študovať masmediálnu komunikáciu je dnes moderné a my sme mali talentovky, ja neviem, či sa teraz ešte robia talentovky. Ako kde? Čiže ten výber ešte pred nejakými 8 rokmi bol podľa mňa veľmi dosť prísny. Nebola to sranda. Naozaj to nebola ani pre mňa sranda. A myslím si, že aj tým, že tých fakult je viac a že si konkurujú, tak nepoznám ich všetky, nechcem to tvrdiť, ale z toho pozorovania produktu tých fakult si myslím, že tie nároky na študentov sú dnes nižšie, ako boli pred 8 rokmi, ktoré poznám ja.
Môžem toto vstúpiť? Ja by som ešte tú tretiu zložku k Lukášovým slovám pridala. A to je zložka médií. Lebo nám sa osvedčilo na katedre, že pokiaľ sú tí študenti správne motivovaní a dá sa im možnosť, tak oni sa potom chytia. Veď Lukáš, ty asi vie, že vo vašej Markíze teraz pracujú dvaja naši študenti, už pracujú, teda Jano Hargaž je ako jeden a pokiaľ viem, tak aj do športu sa teraz jeden z našich študentov dostal, pretože boli motivovaní a dostali tú príležitosť. A to je práve tá cesta, ktorú ja vidím v spolupráci škôl s médiami, aby tie médiá dokázali takýmto spôsobom podchytiť, pretože my máme síce uzavreté zmluvy s Markízou, so Slovenskou televíziou, s rozhlasom, s tlačovými agentúrami, o spolupráci, pomáha nám Ringier, pomáhala nám Penta vybudovať počítačovú učebňu a tak ďalej. Ale taký projekt, ako robíme teraz napríklad zo Slovak Spectator, kde naši študenti tvoria ich produkt a oni im za to poskytujú workshopy a spoluprácu s prestížnymi naozaj špičkovými pracovníkmi. Ja som veľmi z toho potešená, pretože tu vidím cestu, ako by sa to dalo zlepšiť aj to vzdelávanie takýmito konkrétnymi, nie abstraktnými zmluvami, ale takýmito konkrétnymi projektami, ktoré vyústia do konkrétneho výsledku a ten výsledok je k obojstrannej spokojnosti.
I would like to say something about what we're all talking about here in terms of the level of experience of recent graduates. And also, of course, I can imagine they're motivated to find decent paying jobs, or you said maybe for TV, the glamour of being in front of the camera, what have you. I want to just mention a bit about what my experience was in Trnava and teaching young people in general, again, that I just remember how difficult it was. This was in 2008, 2009, a room full of 30 or so Slovak 20-somethings, 20, 21, 22. And I said, this semester, you're going out into the streets, and you're going to be reporting stories, news feature stories, personality profiles. I had major projects for them. And you know what their reaction was? Oh, do we have to talk to real people about real stories, really? It was like a dentist pulling teeth out of them to get them out there, okay? Now, the reason why I say this is because, on the one hand, as a faculty member, okay, there's a lot of responsibility on our shoulders, which is to get them that concrete, hands-on experience, okay? There's nothing like getting out into the streets and let them taste the real thing to get them excited, because only a fool would go into journalism to make money, because you think you're going to make a lot of money, okay? People are going to go into journalism, I believe, primarily, okay, there could be glamour, there could be prestige, there could be respect, right? But ultimately, people have to be, they have to hear some sort of calling. You mentioned that many of your colleagues, or at least a few of your colleagues, feel that sense of mission, right? So, if we assume in this situation that Slovak journalists will never be paid so well, because there will always be people paid better, with better cars and better apartments and better vacations, okay? So how else can you compensate them but to try to nurture at an early age, early enough age, to get them out onto the streets doing concrete journalism to get them excited. Not only does this build experience so that when they come to the TV, the news service, the newspaper, magazine, they've already made a few mistakes, okay? They already have some experience, 1 year, 2 years, writing for the school paper, writing for some professor who's going to make all that effort to edit their articles and to say, you did this wrong, you did that wrong, now get back out there and fill these holes, fix your mistakes. That's a lot of responsibility on our shoulders as teachers, but also then it gets them excited, okay? And then hopefully they can start to overlook the downside of the profession, which is that you're not going to make a lot of money, right? So something has to drive you every day to keep doing the job and to get excited. So I think the region has to encourage that level of enthusiasm.
Ja úplne súhlasím a ja by som rád prečítal jeden list, ktorý možno ukáže na druhej strane problém. A niečo som vytlačil z Facebook. Je to dvoch mojich študentov, ktorí komentujú o inej kurz, a neboli zo Comenius a neboli z Pan-Európskej. Tak niekto tu nemusí sa proste hanbiť, ale ma to prešlo, že zábavný. Chalan píše, pred chvíľou som sa dozvedel, že zajtra do 11.30 mám odovzdať HDDP. Tak to je nejaký dizertačnú prácu, alebo čo? HDDP. Takže závodnečná práca, neviem, čo to je. A o 6.00 odchádzam na 3 dny z Bratislavy. Zadelím, smajlik, smajlik. A slečna píše, to dáš, máš 5 hodín, smajlik. A ja teraz píšem. Chalan, hneď sa mi to lepšie píše, smajlik. Keď mám ešte takých spoluvojúdnikov, palec hore. A ona, palec hore a potom smerom Ctrl-C a Ctrl-V. A on, že asi tak, teraz sa to snažím tak prefintiť, že mi má jeden piatak poslať svoju seminárku, ktorá mi zhodou okolností veľmi podobný názov ako tá moja, smajlik. Ona, že tak dúfam, že ju kdesi nájde, smajlik. Nájde, nájde, treba veriť, smajlik. Ja dúfam, že Erik P., to je asi nejaký profesor, keďže učí na troch školách, cca 300 ľudí to bude, tak fakt len pozrie formálne záležitosti a zatvorí. Ona, že no a ja momentálne som nabitý, no, nie, to je on.
No ja aj momentálne som nabitý u jedného piatáka a ten mi neodporučil to odflaknúť a skopčiť. Ale nechcem ti brať vietor splakieť, samozrejme, smajlík. A on že, a čo sa stalo tým, že čo to odflakli? On to fakt tak poctivo číta a hľada plagiatorov? On že, no tak podľa najnovších informácií od skúsených spiatokov, to len treba dobre zamaskovať a že on až taký problém zase nerobí. Prípadne by sa to dalo neskôr poslať a doriešiť. Inými slovami, za skúšku nič nedáš, smajlík, smajlík. Onže, a ja už mám svoju tému na maili, takto idem omrknúť, smajlík, smajlík. Hotovo, smajlík, smajlík. Ona že, čože? A onže, ale toto je už hnusný plagiat asi aj na mňa. Ona že, smajlík. A ešte dodá, že a nebojíš sa, že sa to zistí? Ja mám rovnaký pocity. No čo už? A onže, listnem to asi, potom to budem riešiť. Teraz ti netreba zaobrať, smajlík. Treba veriť, že to bude spoko loko, smajlík. A ono tu uzavrie, amen. Ja si myslím, že jeden z najdôležitých, že, I'm bothering Slovak, one of the most important qualities of journalists is their characters. That's one thing you can't teach in any school. They have to be fair-minded. They have to be, well, certainly they're not, as Michael was saying, they're not going to be greedy for money because they're not going to get any. But it seems to me that this is part of a wider problem at school, that schools are not seeking and punishing people who cheat. It affects journalism as much as any other course, and I hope that some of my fellows on the panel here can address that aspect, the personal qualities of journalists and whether these are even more important than what schools are formally teaching them.
Yeah. So I will switch to English now as well. Well, yeah, it sounded funny at the beginning, but was indeed not very funny, this situation. Plagiarism and academic dishonesty is a grave problem of the society, and it's connected to all other problems in the society and the question of character. Like, how can you expect people to behave honestly and understand academic honesty if bribery and the cultural corruption and all these misdeeds you watch every time on TV, they go unpunished? Then all the people think that everything will fly. For our university, for our faculty, I can say we try to root out this problem. If they were students of my module, I don't think there are any students, but if this will be online, and they know me quite well, so they know I read every essay, even though I have 100 students, I really read every essay, and it's not hard to see if something is plagiarism. Actually, once I had an essay which was plagiarized so that it was actually my work, and that student even put my name on it. He didn't even edit it.
I had the same experience.
It was it was already so ridiculous. And I say, I have a colleague in my faculty. He teaches classes in psychology and mass media. And I remember one year, he got like 2/3 of his class in front of the disciplinary committee for our faculty for plagiarism. So we obviously cannot kick out 2/3 of our students out of the faculty because they had some kind of misdeeds with regards to citations and in their essay, which is only part of one module. Having said that, I mean, having experience studying for masters at the University of Leeds in England and repression work there really well, they could scare out of people. Just having one bad citation, they will just kick you out of the school. So that's what we don't want to do. But we try to educate our young students that academic dishonesty is something like to steal something from someone. If you have a scientist or someone who writes books, the only regards or the only appreciation you can show him is that you quote him, that you attribute his quote. There's nothing bad on quoting something. But to copy-paste something, it's just plagiarism. It's a They try to do some electronic system how to monitor, which in the end will be ultimately ineffective. I don't know even why they do it. And plagiarism doesn't work like that. They will take something which is already in the system. They can go and just plagiarize a dissertation out of a Czech university. You just go and plagiarize a dissertation out of American university. So this is not going to help out to solve the problem. I think what is really important is my last point, and so I don't want to monopolize this discussion, is the professors. How the students can regard academic honesty as the most important, and the question of character as the most important, if you have accusations of plagiarism and academic dishonesty among the members of faculties. So I hope this will change, and all the members of academia will understand this dishonesty and how it compromises the character. That's the only thing I can say, I guess.
Lukáš, osobné vlastnosti je problém medzi novinármi, hlavne začínajúcich?
Ja začnem asi dobrou správou a odrazím sa od toho plagiatorstva, o ktorom tu bola reč. Už som spomínal tú svoju diplomovú prácu a tam naozaj bol z mojich zistení jeden zo zásadných problémov aj v tom, že sa médiá hanbili citovať iné médiá, najmä konkurenčné, a myslím si, že dnes už to tak nie je, že tu sa už naozaj, keď nie študenti, ale novinári sa v tomto určite posunuli ďalej a už sa nehanbia priznať to, že na niečo prišiel kolega z Osme, na niečo prišiel kolega z Markízy, na niečo prišiel kolega z Joj, ani my nemáme problém zacitovať ani konkurenčnú televíziu. Čiže myslím si, že novinárska obec sa aspoň v takýchto možno dôležitých maličkostiach posunula vpred. A tie osobnostné vlastnosti novinára, tie sú naozaj dôležité a ja tam cítim aj napriek svojmu mladému veku istý rozdiel medzi mojou generáciou alebo tých novinárov, ktorých ja poznám, ktorí sú už v médiách dlhšie, a medzi tými, ktorí do médií prichádzajú teraz, ktorí sú možno 7-8 rokov mladší ako my. A keď sme tu hovorili o tom, že ich treba zapáliť pre vec a že oni sa potom na to chytia a budú radi pracovať, myslím si, že je to ťažké, pretože akokoľvek by sme chceli, tie moje skúsenosti hovoria, že ak sme sa snažili vybudovať si nejaké hniezdo, nejakú zásobáreň, povedzme, že talentov, ktorým sme ale nemohli platiť a nemohli vlastne mohli nám pomáhať, ale jednoducho mali za to nejakú minimálnu mzdu, alebo sme sa im snažili povedať, čak nech prídu nám pomáhať z času na čas, keď budú mať oni čas dobrovoľne, tak jednoducho mladí ľudia dnes si myslia, že jeden deň do televízie prídu, druhý deň im dáme rýchlo kurz geniality a tretí deň ich rodina vo Svidníku, a to nemyslím na nič konkrétne, to som je len prvé miesto, na ktoré som si spomenul, uvidí v televíznych správach, lebo jednoducho, to je to, o čom som už hovoril, že to je ten cieľ. Ich cieľ nie je, mnohých nechcem urážať, pretože cieľ mnohých nie je prinášať ľuďom informácie, pátrať potom, kontrolovať to, čo nikto iný neskontroluje, ale ich cieľ je vidieť sa v televízii a tiež to, aby videla ich rodina v televízii, aby si ich kamaráti hovorili, že jej, ty si bol v televízii. Čiže, ale to je to možno špecifikum tlačené žurnalistiky, televíznej žurnalistiky, ale už som počul aj od kolegov z printových médií, že sú naozaj tie problémy s kvalitnými ľuďmi. Ja si zo svojej redakcie vážim mnohých, ale je jeden kolega, ktorý je odo mňa starší, je skúsený, čiže teoreticky sa na ňoho spolíham tak, že by so mnou nemusel konzultovať žiadnu tému. Žiadnu, ani jednu, a veril by som tomu, že naozaj si overí všetky fakty a poskladá ich tak, ako ich zaznamenal, a nebude s tým žiadny problém. A práve ten človek sa so mnou chodí radiť naozaj o všetkom, kdežto ľudia, ktorí prišli oveľa neskôr a ktoré majú oveľa menšie skúsenosti, jednoducho, a nemyslím si, že to je povahová črta, ja si myslím, že skôr je to črta generácie, ktorá už je, teda nie je to tá moja, že jednoducho tá generácia má pocit, že tie skúsenosti nie je treba. A tam sa opäť dostávame aj k tomu, že jednoducho si tí ľudia nepamätajú, nevedia dať kontext a potom sa stretávame pri triviálnych chybách, ktoré by vyriešila jedna otázka.
One of the things we haven't really talked about so far is what media themselves can do to improve their staff. At a certain Slovak daily, whose name I won't mention, I was amazed by the lack of energy and money that is put into staff development. There's everything from the absolute lack of praise for when you do something good or clear explanations when you do something bad, to a human relations director who was hired to fire people, not because he wanted to identify talents and give them a career path and how they could move up and stay in the profession. He was hired to downsize the company because management didn't want to do the dirty job himself. And my instincts tell me that this is something that is rather widespread in Slovak journalism because I've worked for several different outlets and it seems to be the same at each one. That the media themselves are saying we're not getting quality candidates, there's something wrong here, but at the same time they're not lifting a finger to develop their own talent and to make people feel welcome and that they have a place in the company and that they are wanted. All of which, I believe, as you get older as a journalist and burnout approaches, are very important factors in your decision to stay or go. It's not just the money, and it never has been the money for many older journalists. So I'd just like to open this question up for the panel. Do you think the media could be doing more? And if so, what should they be doing? Mike.
Okay. I'd like to say one thing, that as a freelance journalist over the past 17 years, this has continually been one of my frustrations, is lack of praise from editors, lack of guidance from editors. And so I think this is also part of a pattern. And without knowing the Slovak situation specifically, what's going on the inside, I can imagine that those editors you're talking about may also feel resentful that their boss is not giving them praise and guidance and feedback on how they can do their jobs better. It's something, like I said, I experienced among my editors. Developing their own talents, I think listening to Lukasz, basically, and listening to Branio, I think one thing that the field of journalism may need is for some of its leading lights, okay, some of its finer examples, to go out and do some proselytizing, all right? You go out to speak to journalism faculties, and that they can see by your example how you handle situations, or they come visit your newsroom, you show them around, you can talk to them about ethics. This is what we did in this situation. We will not tolerate this and that, and let them start to look up to you guys. And now I know you're going to say, I'm so busy as it is. I don't have time to go to Košice or Prešov or, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah, well, you know, I think that there has to be something of a, I know crusade is a dangerous word to use nowadays, but there needs to be some crusade toward preaching how journalism ought to be done. And again, keeping the big picture in mind, this is about the health of Slovakia's democracy as well, right? Talking about ethics. And what Branio said about having faculty who are themselves unethical. It's like a parent and a child, right? I mean, of course, do as I do, not as I say. They're looking at the examples. How can a faculty member who's been caught cheating, plagiarizing, talk about ethics? Of course that would be a joke. The kids are smart. And speaking of which, I forgot to mention that, Mike, my students, maybe I painted too dark a picture. I mean, once they got out there, once they were doing, once I forced them out there, so many of them did seem to be really excited about, hey, I'm studying mass media, I'm studying marketing communications, but I like that assignment. I like going out there and digging and digging. I could see not just the brain power and the talent, but also the excitement and all that. And so, yeah, I think you need to send the best representatives of the industry out there and let people get excited looking up to you guys. Build respect. If the respect doesn't exist, and I know it's difficult after what Mr. Fico used to say about the media and really harshly criticizing the media here and reducing the prestige in the eyes of the public and even young students and journalists, but then you have to rebuild it on your own. No one's going to do it for you.
When you think about it, I mean, in terms of feedback for journalists, there's the Open Society Foundation, which holds some journalism awards every year, and the prizes are significant, so it's not just the recognition for journalists, it's also a sum of money which is substantial. And there's the Press Watch, which is the former blog of Gábor Sipos, which is not going on anymore. But there's very little sort of formal recognition, discussion, confrontation of journalist work, and I feel it's not going on in the news departments themselves. What do you think about it, Lukáš? I mean, are you doing enough, you think, to hold on to your people, develop them?
I don't think so. No? Nemyslím si, že robím dosť, pretože... A myslím si, že to je špecifikum tejto doby, ktorá je rýchla a je o peniazoch a v konečnom dôsledku aj naša televízia je firma, ktorá má zarábať peniaze. Čiže aj my hľadáme rezervy, aj my robíme veci tak, že redaktor je nielen redaktor a písateľ textu, ale v konečnom dôsledku tie reportáže aj sám technicky strihá, čiže musí mať aj musí zvládnuť aj vizuálnu stránku veci. A takisto je to aj v mojom prípade. Ja nie som len šéf-redaktor, ktorý by sa mohol venovať len čisto redakčnému vedeniu newsroomu, ale musím sa venovať aj ekonomickým záležitostiam a podobným veciam v rámci firmy. Čiže tie úspory sú na všetkých úrovniach a snažíme sa aj my o veľkú efektivitu. Ale zase na druhej strane to v mojom prípade prináša to, že nevždy dokážem urobiť všetko to, aj keď sa snažím dávať ľuďom spätnú väzbu, učiť ich, ukazovať im veci, ako ich nerobiť, ako ich robiť. Mnohokrát to skončí pri e-mailových pokynoch, lebo jednoducho je to najjednoduchšia cesta, je napísať do e-mailu, nerobte toto tak, ale robte to tak, ako každému jednému to vysvetliť, pričom pri 60-člennej redakcii by som pri tom strávil 2 týždne, aby som to vysvetlil. Čiže určite môžu médiá robiť viac. My sa o to snažíme. Máme konzultantov, ktorí chodia v istých nepravidelných intervaloch ľuďom ukazovať nové trendy, učiť ich nové veci. Máme externú spätnú väzbu, kde môžeme redaktorom ukázať konkrétne veci, ktoré v príspevkoch a v reportážach nerobia dobre. Asi najväčšia motivácia pre mojich ľudí je z času na čas dostaneme ponuku na stáž do CNN na 3 týždne. Boli už 4 redaktori, čiže to je veľká vec a to je veľká motivácia. Ale tá najlepšia a najväčšia motivácia je vždy výsledok. A keď prídu pozitívne ohlasy od ľudí, keď jednoducho celá redakcia na niečom pracovala a my to neradi hovoríme, že keď sa niečo deje, tak ľudia sa obracajú na Markízu a pozerajú sa, lebo často sú to aj negatívne udalosti, napríklad keď spadlo lietadlo s poľským prezidentom, nikde o tom nehovoríme, jednoducho sledovanosť bola vysoká, ale myslím si, že sme to zvládli profesionálne a naozaj ľudia, pozitívny príklad je, sú voľby, keď aby som nehovoril o tragédiách, jednoducho keď udalosť, do ktorej je zapojený celý tím a dopadne to naozaj dobre, aj keď to stálo veľa peňazí, jednoducho vtedy sú tí ľudia šťastní a vtedy naozaj, myslím si, že to ich nabíja pozitívnou energiou zase na tie bežné obdobia, na tú dennú rutinu, ktorá naozaj nie je ľahká. Lebo tú reportáž treba vyrobiť a síce možno máme taký priestor na to, aby robil redaktor aj viac dní na téme a máme aj našich investigatívnych reportérov, ktorých sme presunuli zo zrušenej relácie Palba. Ale ten tlak je tam aj na produktivitu na redaktorov. Čiže ten tlak je zo všetkých strán, lebo je to v konečnom dôsledku firma, ktorá má zarábať peniaze. Ale snažíme sa robiť všetko preto, aby tí ľudia dostávali čo najviac, aj keď nehovorím, že robím ja osobne dosť.
It seems that certainly the formal institutions that exist in this country that deal with media, like the Syndicate of Journalists and Tlačová rada, I've always found them personally rather irrelevant. I don't want to offend anybody, but they haven't, to my mind, had a great impact on shaping and commenting on the direction of Slovak media. And in fact, the SME newspaper, when I worked there, I was sued by the head of the Slovak Land Fund over the stories we were writing about restitucia under the Tatras. And in court, it turned out that I had been censored by the Tlačová rada, but I had never been told of this. I had never been called on them to explain anything about the story. So a greater example to me of irrelevance, I haven't found yet, that a media body would issue a decision without communicating it or consulting with the person who was censured. Anyway, and we won the court case. So, I'm sorry? The court was lying? it wasn't actually the court, it was the plaintiff who was presenting this evidence in his attack, and he lost. But it strikes me that universities have a place here that that is missing. I mean, in this transition between journalists leaving your schools and moving into journalism, do you keep touch with these people, and do you have any kind of forum for commenting on the media? Because you are the formal experts in this country.
Tá spolupráca s médiami možno by mala aj tak vyzerať, aby tá spätná väzba, pardon, potom fungovala aj naďalej, pretože mali sme takú spoluprácu s tlačovou agentúrou, kde aj po skončení chodili na žiadosť agentúry naši ľudia ďalej vzdelávať v tých veciach, ktorých pociťovala tá agentúra potrebu. Takže možno by to bolo. My sme žiadaní od vedenia našej fakulty, aby sme evidovali, kam, kde sa naši absolventi uplatňujú, ale pokiaľ samotní absolventi neprejavia o to záujem, aby s nami ostali v kontakte, tak nemáme možnosť my túto vec skúmať. Jedine, čo dostávame spätnú väzbu, je v tom, či teda sa uplatňujú. Nezamestnanosť alebo zamestnanosť. Toto môžeme my zodpovedne dokladať, že teda absolventi našej katedry nie sú nezamestnaní. Zatiaľ ako takéto informácie sme nedostali. Ale tá spätná väzba s bývalými absolventami je vždy potom len na tej dobrovoľnej báze.
Do you think it's something, it's possibly a role for universities in this climate in which everybody is cutting investigative departments, there is simply no money for it, that you would set up some kind of center which has resources, which has gives feedback, and again, constantly commenting on what is being done in the media from the role of a formal expert, of an academic expert. I don't see it being done, but I don't know whether you think it's an appropriate role for you or not.
I think it's very appropriate role for universities to do it. Who should do it if not, as you pointed, if not the experts? And the students should be the experts of tomorrow, especially the doctoral students. And we have some doctoral students who work as well at Markiza. To the first point, whether we have any feedback from our former student, from our alumni, or from the people from the newsrooms. Yes, we do. I got a feedback today and from you as well. And we do feedback with students how they like our modules, and as well we ask them, because an internship in the newsroom is a module at our faculty, so we have a bit of feedback of that, and we have feedback from our faculty members. What is a concept of our university and of our faculty of media is to have as really many people who go from the practical media. You take it either from journalism, like you teach investigative journalism because that's your field of practice, that is where you excel. And then we have, you know, in public relations, marketing communications, camera, photography, and all other stuff is really taught by people who are actually not from academia. We have a kind of a large staff of people which go from academia because we need it for accreditation, but our focus is to have really as many people as possible to work from actually the practical environment, and their feedback on our students is a very valuable feedback. Of course, criticism should be provided as well if something is made good. When to answer your question whether university should establish some kind of watchdog and discuss the misdeeds in media. While we're having chat, we're talking about this. Maybe it will materialize soon, and I hope that my university and my faculty can play a role in being a hub for information of this kind, and there will be an opportunity to take up this challenge.
Yeah, Mike. I'd like to say something about that because this discussion just sparked an idea for me that I think that the U.S. Embassy, given its support of independent media here demonstrated today, may want to get financially involved with. Just hear me out, okay? Just a couple weeks ago, I got an email from an American environmental activist I know in Beijing. Okay, now I'm teaching in Hong Kong and with mainland students, so he knows I'm working with young Chinese journalists. And he said, Michael, I know a young Chinese reporter in Beijing who's writing in English and really wants some feedback, but is getting no feedback from her editors, okay, at her Beijing newspaper. Would you mind serving as something of a mentor to her? I'm like, yeah, I'd be happy to. But, you know, I have a lot of things to do as well, okay? I'm sure my faculty colleagues will say, yeah, we're very busy, okay, to squeeze one more thing. And I was thinking, and I wouldn't be paid for this, so this would just be of my own sense of giving something back to society, to the Chinese who need it, right? And now I'm thinking, actually, one thing that might be very, very useful, and again, speaking with Chase Beamer and others from the embassy, I know that there's strong support for doing something. And maybe if you could fund some sort of mentor program, okay? Some little financial incentive for not just faculty, former faculty of these young journalists, but even people like Lukasz and other journalists to somehow carve out a bit of time in their busy schedules to work specifically with one or two young journalists, okay? Because when you think about that, they would get great feedback, how I can become a better journalist, and it would help motivate them. It's like, you know, I really look up to Lukasz, I look up to Svetlana, and look, they're giving me feedback, they care, I know they're getting paid, but they're not getting paid a lot, obviously, some sort of financial incentive. And also, it would solidify, I think, that bridge between graduation and starting out and getting no guidance, no professional development, but feeling this pressure, not making a lot of money, but at least someone's trying to help me do my job better and to become a better young professional, even a better grown-up, okay? So I don't know how much this would cost, right? But why not start small scale, you know, a little pilot project with five mentors? Why not?
That's an interesting idea. For it to work, obviously, you need older people to be there as mentors. I'm 44. I'm sort of still hanging around, maybe like an old smell. But Lukasz, do you want guys like me in the newsroom? And if you do, how do you keep older journalists interested going in the profession?
Yes.
Áno, samozrejme.
No, that wasn't a job request. It was not. It's more. I mean, are older journalists actually the asset that we've been sort of saying that they are? And if they are an asset, how do we keep them?
Začnem asi príbehom z doby nedávno minulej, keď sme sa snažili obsadiť jedno miesto. A v mojej kancelárii sa striedali dve adeptky a jedna bola tesne po skončení vysokej školy a druhá bola už dlhoročná novinárka. A tá druhá, tá staršia, no mala 35 rokov, sa ma opýtala, že ja viem, že to nedostanem, lebo tá druhá bola mladšia. A ja som jej povedal, nie, to nehrá rolu, pretože my hľadáme človeka, ktorý nemusí byť mladý vekom, ale radšej sme si overili, že jednoducho tá skúsenosť je oveľa dôležitejšia ako energia, lebo už sme tu o tom hovorili, že skúsenosť prináša zo sebou aj rozvahu a správne rozhodnutia, kdežto tá mladosť, pochabosť je niekedy aj na škodu veci. A takže pokojne ťa privítam vo svojom newsroome.
Why do you think older journalists leave in Slovakia? Because it's one of the things you really notice when you travel back to Canada or the States in the summer and you watch the news.
They're all old farts, you know, the gray hair, but somehow they have the air of credibility, whereas in Slovakia, sometimes TV stations seem to compete in youth. Why do they leave?
Možno je to o tom, že začínajú prískoro. Že žurnalistika, ja som začínal, ja si naozaj myslím, že nikde v zahraničí by sa mi to nepodarilo. Ja som začínal pri vysokej škole v SME ako 19-ročný písať do celoštátneho denníka aj o politike. A presne sme sa o tom s kolegami, vtedy spolu študentami rozprávali, že jednoducho niekde v zahraničí by som ešte 5 rokov nosil pera, nosil kávu, pera a robil pre niekoho research, a jednoducho bol by som pomocník a po 5 rokoch by mi možno dovolili napísať nejaký krátky článok, kdežto tu tí ľudia začínajú naozaj skoro. Nechcem povedať, že vyhoria, lebo nie všetci vyhoria, ale jednoducho, ak nie sú pre tú žurnalistiku nadšení, tak v 30-ke príde na nich to, že chcú skúsiť niečo nové. A naozaj to mám zažité z rozhovorov a s dobrými novinármi, Gábor Grendel, Ľubo Schwarzbacher, z minulého leta odišli 4 alebo 3 dosť kľúčoví ľudia z našej redakcie a dosť som mal problém nahradiť ich v priebehu 2 mesiacov a oni povedali, že jednoducho chcú robiť niečo iné, lebo sú už unavení 5-10 rokov v žurnalistike. Čiže možno je ten dôvod aj ten skorý začiatok, aj to, že sa doba zmenila, ale ja som vnútorne stále presvedčený, že ak niekto je novinár dušou, tak tým novinárom aj zostane, aj keď bude mať 60 rokov. A ak pôjdeme k tomu feedbacku, o ktorom sa tu pred chvíľou hovorilo, myslím si, že novinársky problém je aj v tom, že novinári sú alebo sme, aby to bolo úplne korektné, že sme sebastrední a ješitní a veľmi ťažko prijímame kritiku. A nehovorím, že bývalý premiér mal vo všetkom pravdu, ale namiesto toho, aby sme sa nad niektorými jeho slovami zamysleli, tak sme sa novinári väčšinou naježili a nepočúvali to a brali to ako istý boj a reagovali sme bojom. A myslím si, že nie vždy je dobré reagovať útokom, ale možno zamyslieť sa, zobrať si z toho to, čo je naozaj podnetné. Spomeniem lyžovačku, novinárska lyžovačka, a to bol premiér Fico, ktorý ju vyťahol. A myslím si, že tiež táto kauza mala istý vplyv na novinársku obec, že sa v mnohých redakciách aj do toho nové zaviedli pravidlá, kedy sa chodí a na aké cesty a za akých podmienok a čo si platí redakcia a čo môže prijať. Aspoň v našej redakcii to tak funguje. A myslím si, ešte jednu vec by som len povedal, že za posledné roky najväčšiu robotu pre slovenskú žurnalistiku si myslím, že naozaj urobil Gábor Šípoš, nadšenec, ktorý nikdy žurnalista nebol a možno aj to bolo dobré. A ja si myslím, že niečo také, lebo svojím spôsobom, ak odmyslíme všetkých tých, ktorí reagovali urazene na Gabovú kritiku, tak sa stal istou takou autoritou a myslím si, že sa mu podarilo odhaliť viacero vecí, ktoré pomohli. Keďže my nie sme veľmi schopní sa sami čistiť, spomedzi seba vypudiť to zlé alebo ťažko to robíme, tak Gabovi sa to aspoň podarilo a myslím si, že je ťažké ho nahradiť, aj keď napríklad teraz je na mediálnom, je nový projekt Media Watch, tak si myslím, že to je ešte ďaleká cesta a máme preto myšlienku aj v rámci IPI Slovensko ako v spolupráci s univerzitami možno urobiť niečo také, čo by bolo generálne akceptované, aby to robili ľudia, ktorí by boli akceptovaní a jednoducho vytvoriť nejakú autoritu pre novinárov, pretože tlačová rada síce existuje, ale je to samoregulačný etický orgán, ale je stále utlačená do úzadia a aj z tvojich slov vyplýva, že jednoducho ani ona je pretlačené médiá, ani tí novinári, ktorých by sa mala týkať, ju až tak veľmi nerešpektujú. Čiže myslím si, ale je to naozaj o tej misii, že ak tu bude skupina ľudí, ktorí urobia tú misiu pre tú slovenskú žurnalistiku, že sa možno niekam posunieme.
As one of the older journalists in Slovakia, apart from the immortal Enio Korda, I say one of the things that really wears you out is the constant žaloby. I recently wrote about Eurofans, and I was sure that I had checked every single fact and double-checked. And then I got a call from Oliver Brunovsky. This woman is really pissed off, and she sent in a žaloba. She wants to meet us all on Tuesday. So, you know, you go through it again. You don't sleep much. You're asking yourself, could I have done anything wrong? In the end, it was fine. She was totally full of it, and we didn't have to retract anything. But, you know, you think, I'm too old for this. This constant bashing your head up against people and fighting with these stupid jalopy and corrections and complaints and so on. And at the same time, as an older journalist, you find that there are some stories that you just can't get published. That you know, younger journalists maybe who are your bosses, like Matúš Kostolný in SME was my former student. It's about 10 years between us. And he's a great guy. But that, you know, there's a generation of younger journalists who sometimes just don't get the importance of a story. And it seems frustrating that you can't sort of get the ball past the goalkeeper, so to speak. So it's, I mean, I plan to stay a journalist as long as I can, but I can see why so many of my colleagues hang up the towel, you know, and take off. I think probably now it's a good time to open the floor to some questions and some comments. The last issue I would like to address among us is what can be done to change and improve the situation. So ideas from the floor would be very welcome in that regard, and maybe we could think a little bit on how to end this discussion on a positive note, one of constructive ideas rather than just criticism for the poor old Slovak journalist who suffered so much and has paid so little.
Ďakujem pekne za slovo. Som Zuzana Krútka, podpredsednička Slovenského syndikátu novinárov. Ja by som chcela nadviazať práve na pána Jordana, lebo rodí sa nám taký jeden mentorsko-tutorovský systém práve teraz. Dostali sme také pripomienky vlastne práve z katedry pani Hlavčákovej, pani docentkej Hlavčákovej, že majú problémy zariadiť v redakciách tieto stáže pre študentov, ktoré sú vlastne povinné pre študentov, pretože redakcie vlastne nemajú ľudí, ktorí by sa týmto študentom venovali. To je ako problém. Kedysi mali novinári viac času a v podstate s radosťou ako týchto elevov proste viedli a venovali sa im. Takže cez Slovenský syndikát novinárov organizujeme teraz takúto aktivitu, že oslovujeme redakcie, zatiaľ ešte nemáme spätnú väzbu, to je absolútne čerstvá záležitosť. Ale zároveň máme klub seniorov, čo sú ľudia stále srdcom a dušou, ktorí zostali novinári a ktorí sú úplne nadšení tým, že môžu, že majú vlastne príležitosť robiť tútorov týmto mladým študentom. Takže tí sú vlastne pripravení a vlastne oni by mali nahradiť tých redakčných tútorov, pričom teda redakcia bude zadávať študentom úlohy. Tak veľmi dúfame, že to vyjde a že za týchto podmienok už tie redakcie vlastne tých študentov príjmu. Toľko som chcela povedať ako tak možno nejaké svetielko nádeje.
Ďakujem za info.
Can I just say one thing about that? If I understood correctly, you said that seniors are tutoring freshmen or the elder, okay. Because it also sounds like I like that idea. I mean, I hope ultimately it works out and they motivate each other to move forward. But then, like I said, I see now listening to you all that there is that need for the bridge. When you're in university, it's still theoretical what your work life is going to be like. Then they see the reality, and some of them say, it's not for me. Or I heard about this job, I can go into PR or politics or whatever the case may be, something that's more attractive. So I would like to see something like that mentor program then extended, right? The next year, 2 years, I mean, this is really for new journalists. This is for a new journalist mentoring program, how to keep them motivated and enthusiastic about the field. Give them something more than the salary they're going to make, but feedback, which is really very important, and that praise or that sort of thing, that they feel they see their name on TV or in a newspaper, whatever, and they feel that sense of, I like that. I like to see my byline. I like that sort of feedback, and that's going to keep me going rather than some of these other factors we're talking about or complaining about.
Some of you may know Jan Glovičko. He's a young reporter for SME. He did a series of articles on Comenius University, for which he was both rewarded by the university and punished. but his first day in the newsroom, I think, was 2007 sometime, and he was just thrown to me, like Nicholson, just take him and do something with him. And I was doing an article on Jan Slota and a multi-billion tender, and he had to come along with me and experience, you know, in that one day, Slota and deadlines and writing the story, and he really got thrown off the deep end. But it's true, there isn't time, there aren't people in media themselves to really venovat, you know, these young journalists. Is it the same in Markiza, that you guys just don't have the capacity? So it's a pity.
The wheel
is there, but the...
I have to say one more thing now based on what Tom just said, which is what Tom is referring to is what we call shoulder-to-shoulder training. Okay? Now, I can also see expanding that mentor program. The money's there, okay? Just ask Washington, all right? The money's there to expand the program so that then you're also taking some of these young journalists or seniors out into the field, right? Let me show you, kid, how this is done. Okay, again, with some of the leading lights, start off with something smaller scale, but gain that shoulder-to-shoulder training that, again, serves many purposes. It gets them excited, but also teaches them the ethics that you say, obviously, are so important. That I forgot to mention before, I caught students at my university in New York plagiarizing. I've caught students in China plagiarizing. So, again, it's nothing uniquely Slovak, the issue of plagiarism. But getting back to your point, or any other questions from
teraz mi zobral vietor z plachat, lebo dve témy sa otvorili k tomu plagiatorstvu. Ja sa tiež vrátim. Ja si pamätám, keď sme prišli do Švédska, tak prvý rok sa stala taká vec, že médiá zverejnili meno študenta, ktorý odpisoval na maturitách. A v zápätí v priebehu jedného týždňa vydali vyhlásenia univerzity švédske o tom, že toho študenta odmietajú prijať na štúdium. Za to, že podvádzal pri maturite. Ale to je fenomén celospoločenský. To je fenomén, kde podvodník v triede, ktorý okabáti učiteľa, nie je najväčší frajer, ale kde je ten podvodník odsúdenia hodný. Čiže to nie je len otázka médií alebo vysokých škôl mediálnych, ale to je otázka celospoločenská, aby sa vôbec toto ponímanie u ľudí nejakým spôsobom zmenilo. A hovorili sme o čom?
Mentorstvo.
Mentorstvo. Áno, tu zase vidím, ale aktivitu aj zo strany samotných, potrebnú aktivitu zo strany samotných redakcií, pretože ja teda som naozaj vykopávka v istom zmysle, a moji kolegovia, ktorí ešte pôsobia v médiách, majú napríklad aj také skúsenosti, kde im, my to tak už voláme v našom veku, že kinder management, kde im 30-ročný šéf-redaktor povie, že ľudia po 50-ke by mali ísť, sa vrátiť do hrobu, doslova do písmena, mali by ísť do dôchodku. Takže aj tí mladí ľudia a mladý manažment a mladí novinári by museli mať záujem o to, aby to mentorstvo fungovalo, pretože inak by to bolo zase len niečo vynútené.
Tiež som počul niekoľkokrát od, neviem, či od veľvyslanectiev alebo Open Society, ale že sa ponúka tieto rôzne školenie, ale ten záujem je malý medzi novinármi a čo s tým. No. Anybody else have anything to say about Slovak journalism? There's a young man in the back there, young lady, sorry. My eyesight is very bad. It's nothing about your appearance.
Hello, my name is Jakub Šimek. I just had a small suggestion about an alternative to this mentorship would be crowdsourcing, basically either for students. I don't know if the students are blogging, but if you're blogging, then you've got so many negative reactions, then if you don't check your facts, you're, even the teacher can see it, of course. And I have a friend who started to blog for another, more let's say, better blogging site, and he was even he was accused that he's plagiarizing the style, not you know the style of someone else. So you know, this is one thing is crowdsourcing definitely, and then yeah, and also about the plagiarizing, you need to be positive. It's not about I think plagiarizing is for the poor students. The rich ones are gonna buy the whole paper, and it's basically untraceable. So I would say maybe it's like, why would you even plagiarize? Because then what's point? Are you gonna be a secretary, you know, or something? It's like the school should be for you. So it's something positive, and also maybe writing up to date, like about up to date things which cannot be plagiarized or something. And yeah, and I think generally the Slovak market is small, so there needs to be some in small and very concentrated. I'm not talking about journalists, but let's say advertisers. This is another thing. We are talking about corruption in politics, but are you gonna criticize your major advertiser? I'm not so sure. I mean, maybe you want to be a little bit. So there are many questions to be asked, and I think we need to be inventive and kind of bring innovation for this small market, to bring up quality.
I had just a small reaction. Interesting point. I would say if someone buys a paper, a dissertation, a thesis, or anything, it's well plagiarism. Because plagiarism means that you're saying about the work of someone else that it's your own work and it's not his work. It's work of someone who bought it. You cannot. It's untraceable. Yeah, it is. That's why I try to say, like, people have to understand in the society that character matters. That character is important. That where Tom's question was pointing at. It is important, and we have positive examples in our society that character is important. And that you pointed that to have more up-to-date topics on the essays and thesis and stuff like this. For example, I try to do on my modules, I put questions. So questions that would be, you have to think about the question and then you have to answer the question through the essay. That would be the way. I had one experience with one student. She told, she wrote an essay and I told her, like, look, this essay is totally off topic. It's not even about this. And she said, oh, you know, I put that question into Google and that's what I got. So...
Very, very briefly, one very, very short comment. About the plagiarism, you're absolutely right. It's a problem throughout Slovak society. When you have a policeman like Jaroslav Spišiak, who is supposed to represent the absolute sort of cleanest of the clean, and he has two men that he appointed, is it Ludovit Abel and Jan Valo, who it's pretty obvious they plagiarized their dissertation work. And he says he's not going to fire them, but he's going to wait until the results of some survey at some point. You know, if that's what people are saying in his position, then everybody else can't be expected to get any other kind of message. I mean, this country, theft is absolutely rife in this country. Theft in privatization, theft in public procurement, theft of small živnostníci who don't report their incomes, it's everywhere. And so... it's not surprising that that journalists and students are basically human like the rest of society and are doing what they're allowed to do.
I'd like to just say one thing about the blogging. I love the idea. And I want to talk about this for a second because this is really one of my passions now is getting young journalists, young student journalists involved at blogging. In fact, last September, the university where I teach, Hong Kong Baptist University, brought me out there specifically to start all 77 of their students on their own blog. And not the kind of blog where then we went to the Stare Mesto, we went to the Krčma, we drank da-da-da. No, well, I'm talking about journalistic blogs, right? That even at a young age, and you know how addictive the idea of seeing your own words on Facebook, Twitter, whatever. I mean, look, it's creating mental illness worldwide, right? That everyone thinks their words are so valuable. But blogging, getting young journalists involved in blogging, because they may be frustrated. Oh, our school newspaper is no good, our school magazine, or if I write an article for a professor, where's it published? I don't see it. I get a grade, I get a mark, whatever.
blogging, as I encourage them all to do, first of all, they can also do it in English, so they're working on improving their English language skills. But also, just to get them that sense of, I can go out, if I have an interesting conversation with a taxi driver or with a shopkeeper, or I want to write about a situation, there's a neo-Nazi demonstration, I want to write about it for my blog. I, on Sunday afternoon, I'm going to produce some journalism at age 20, and I'm going to publish it, and people are going to see it. And again, it's about getting them experience, and it's also about building excitement for journalism itself. And blogging is I think, the best way to do it. Plus, editors, then in the future, when you say, I like a job as a starting reporter, and you say, well, show me what you've done. I don't see anything from Comenius that you've done or from Ternava. You say, oh, here's the address for my blog. Let me show you my work on my blog. Okay, so it's also great marketing for the young people as well. That's my pitch. I'm not being paid by the Blogging Association, right?
Thank you, sir. You had a comment?
Yeah, hi. my name is Michael Srba. I'm currently living in Slovakia for 4.5 years, and I work for the Slovak Governance Institute. By the way, we are also having one of our projects, which is demagogue.sk, which is a fact-checking website. So we do check, for instance, statements politicians make during the Sunday discussions on television, eventually also in other media. But I would like to say that as coming from abroad and being a very heavy media consumer myself, one of the things that are missing, in my view, is a kind of, the Ted Koppel person, Jeremy Paxman, BBC, type of journalism. And yes, I do understand that from the past you have a certain legacy where either politicians or you are being sued or facing these kind of threats. I surely understand. However, I would like to pinpoint one other thing. If we go back into history, and it's for those who know the name Emile Zola, but he wrote the open letter in the French press after the Dreyfus court hearings, where Dreyfus was unjustifiably sentenced. It changed the atmosphere, the public against, especially the courts. Yes, I know the courts are a little bit shaky in Slovakia. When you go to court, you're never sure you have a fair trial. But the more we keep quiet, the more we simply conform ourselves to, okay, what is the habit and what is the tradition according to the countries, we will never get out of this circle, I think. Yes, we deal with a lack of funding for the schools. We have poor management where managers downsize staff instead of coaching and supporting them, yes. But I think if the four panelists, or including Tom, actually, if these five people, who have a certain, I believe, a certain vision and a certain idea, I think you should instill also this idea that a journalist, if the courts are bad or if the politicians are corrupt, whatever, if the journalists do not give out this message to the broad public will never realize, and there will never be this eagerness, this willingness to get investigative journalism, etc. So this is just a thought I wanted to share with you.
I just add one thing to that. I just drew a rather strange parallel here between journalists and Roma, or gypsies, okay? That, for example, if there's criticism of racism in society, I'm not going to get into that so much, but if it were just Roma activists speaking out against this or that, right? The public, the majority could say, it's just a Roma complaint, just a gypsies complaint, okay? If it's only journalists who are complaining about pressure, political pressure, economic pressure, about quality of democracy, that's not going to be enough. The journalists are complaining. I think you also need non-journalists, right, who also recognize the value of freedom of speech, freedom of expression, the rights of journalists, that sort of thing. So non-journalists defending the cause as well, right? So to expand that web there of supporters.
It's kind of interconnected in a way, but I see it as a kind of educational process as well. So the journalists are the one who emit their messages to the public and let the public after a while, I mean, if you tell them once or twice, they forget. But if you tell them 100 times that there's something really fishy or going bad, then they start realizing it in the end, and that will bring up new ideas or new movements in society.
I have only one small comment why we don't have Jeremy Paxman here in Slovakia, because our Jeremy Paxman is Nižňanský, the former director of Slovak television. So guys like Jeremy Paxman in his age, where most of it active journalists in the age of communism, which I don't want to, of course, say like all journalists were like Nižňanský, but you say like when we were talking about character, don't want to say talk about anyone actual character, but the moral devastation during communism that happened here, the transformation and transition is part of it. So I would again return to this question like of positive examples that the people of this country have to realize the importance of media. And I don't know, I think it was Thomas Jefferson who said if he had to see a government without media or media without the government, he would go for media without the government. So people have to realize this, that this is the utmost importance. The public has to see the need for media. And it was quite a good example from Hungary that you cannot just... I just want to have a cheap vacation somewhere, to have a car, to... gas price being low, and then I don't care about anything. And I hope that this will change and that character will prevail and people will understand this.
Ja možno len jeden taký komentár k tomu, či si ľudia uvedomujú vplyv médií a ako vnímajú vlastne tieto veci a upozorňovanie na celospoločenské neduhy a na to, čo v spoločnosti nefunguje. A máme takú redakčnú depresiu, by som to nazval, že je to paradoxné, je to, myslím si, v istom zmysle aj smutné, že keď odvysielame reportáž o tom, že niekto týral psa, a teraz nechcem znižovať hodnotu psa ani nič, tak je to povedať, tak jednoducho dostaneme stovky reakcií, stovky e-mailov, ozvú sa stovky ľudí, ktorí si toho psa chcú adoptovať. A keď odvysielame reportáž o tom, že chudobná rodina, a to je jedno, či nás píši na východnom Slovensku, na južnom Slovensku, kdekoľvek, nemá čo jesť, žije zo 100 eur, tak jednoducho tých reakcií je 100-násobne menej. Ako vždy sa nájde, a vždy si máme z toho dobrý pocit, keď sa nájde nemenovaný, neznámy, ktorý nie je ani nám známy človek, ktorému len odovzdáme číslo na tú rodinu a ktorý tej rodine nejako pomôže. Ale jednoducho chcem len poukázať na to, že to je paradox, že pokiaľ upozorňujeme na celospoločenské neduhy, tak ľudia sú tohto veľkého rangu, by som to nazval, aj keď nechcem znižovať naozaj týranie zvierat, je to tiež spoločenský neduh. Že jednoducho ľudia to vnímajú jedným uchom dnu, druhým uchom von, ako pánske huncúctvo, keď to preženiem. A je naozaj ťažké dostať do hlav divákov niečo, že je naozaj problém. To je naozaj ťažké presvedčiť diváka o tom, že toto je problém. Pokiaľ to podávam v spravodajstve, lebo my nemáme žiadne analýzy ani komentáre, len cez fakty.
Very briefly, I think what we were talking about was in Italy it was called the virtuous minority. When, I don't know if you remember, in the early 1990s, the mafia blew up two judges. One of them was named Paolo Borsellino, I forget the other judge's name, who were anti-mafia judges. Falcone. And there was a reaction from all sectors of society, including the media, but certainly not restricted to the media. And the virtuous minority in any society is essentially what saves it from descending into complete chaos or being taken over by the worst elements. And in Slovakia, there was a very strong virtuous minority in the 1990s under Mečiar. One of the things I loved when I got into journalism, because you really felt like you were part of a community, not limited to journalists. But that virtuous minority is really dwindling today, not just as expressed in the paucity of reactions to stories, but also people kind of throwing in the towel and saying it's not worth getting involved. And you can see it in the judicial sector, where Harabin has made it, you know, absolutely lethal to speak up and speak out against him. And in other professions as well, there are many fewer people these days signing on to simply stand up against evil, against wrong in society. And I think that's one of the reasons we're still in the place we are. So, sorry, sir.
Ja som Miloš Mistrík. Ťažko sa do tej diskusie zapája, pretože ja som sa hlásil už dávnejšie, tak sa musím vrátiť teraz k niečomu. Teda chcel som sa odraziť od tej témy plagiatorstva. Čo mne teda na tom plagiatorstve vadí, nie ani to, že teda niekto bol veľmi šikovný a odpísal od niekiaľ, čo teda tiež mi vadí, ale ešte jedna vec je viac, čo mi vadí, že on odmietol byť samým sebou. Že odmietol byť osobnosťou. A to je veľmi zlý vstup do tejto sféry. To, čo ste hovorili aj tuto môj kolega, že vlastne nerastú veľké osobnosti stále. Neviem, či asi aj taká doba, že už nie sú také veľké osobnosti, ako bývali v žurnalistike alebo v literatúre, ale jednoducho nerastú a je to veľká chyba vedieť sa postaviť proti istému aj názorovému prúdu, ktorý prevažuje, ak je nesprávny. To je prípad Dreyfusa, napríklad, ktorý, teda aféry Dreyfusovej, nie Dreyfusa priamo, ale teda známej Zolovej aféry. A vyplýva to aj z toho, teda, že naši mladí študenti, povedzme však aj ja učím, popri tom, čo robím, tak stále si nechávam študentov, pretože ma to obohacuje. Oni teda poprvé niektorí nechcú byť ani osobnosťami, ale podruhé nemajú vedomosti, nemajú znalosti. Ja keby som sa spýtal, a možno si to dám za cieľ, ale vidím tu nejakých mojich študentov, takže oni to prezradia, ale ja môžem sa ich spýtať na budúci útorok, že či vedia niečo o afére Dreyfusa. Obávam sa, ale už som to povedal, takže no, keď to priamo v miestnosti dám, no ale už som to prezradil, takže to neurobím. Prosím? No, tak áno, to je pravda, že hneď mi odpovie o chvíľu. Odpovedia. No, je to proste problém naozaj aj v tom, že však teda zodpovedne asi za to školstvo, takže to je sebakritika, že moji študenti nevedia, čo je to Dreyfus, no, ale ja zasa nemusím učiť všetko naozaj dejiny francúzskej literatúry a francúzskej politiky konca 19. storočia, ale proste je tu aj to, že ja to nerad vidím, ale však ja teda nejaký čas učím a z mojich študentov mnohí sa stali veľmi rýchlo investigatívci. Teraz som ich videl, najprv prišli do školy a ledva niečo vedeli a potom skončili školu, až boli investigatívci. Prešli, mám pred očami jednu konkrétnu dámu, ktorá prešla veľkým oblúkom, postavila sa proti všem. Teraz ju to vyplulo, lebo ona, vlastne v nej nebolo nič iné, len nejaké to gesto. To gesto urobila, prešla z jednej televízie do novín a už ani neviem, kde je. Zmizla. Proste nemá vnútornú, aj to je treba vedieť, lebo nie je to nejaké hrdinské gesto, ale musí byť v ňom, vo vzdelaní, povedzme, vo vedomostiach, ale proste v tej osobnosti. A toho sa mi troška máli. No.
Thank you for your comment. It's getting on for 7 o'clock. Time, I guess, to wrap this sucker up. Does anybody have anything else that they really need to get off their chest? Doesn't appear so right now. Chase. No, I think we've had we've heard some really useful ideas from the audience and from the panel. Among them, I guess mentoring is probably the one that has come up the most often. I think the potential for university and media cooperation is great because, as we've heard, the media want to keep people, they want to improve the quality of their staff, but simply monetary realities being what they are, they're under a great deal of strain. So I think these two directions offer some very fertile ground for progress. Anyway, I'd like to thank you all for coming out on this nice May evening. I'd like to thank our four panelists very much for volunteering their time, and hope to see you for coffee or drinks or whatever the society has laid on for us. If not, then see you again soon in the future. Thank you very much.